What's up, cinephiles? For this episode, we are going to review Mank, a Netflix movie directed by David Fincher. Now, if you are new to our channel, consider leaving a like and subscribing to us for weekly reviews of movies, TV shows, and video games. Now, Kevin, what is this movie all about?
Now, Mank is a story written by Jack Fincher, the father of David Fincher, and it tells about the story of Herman Mankiewicz. He is the writer for the highly regarded work Citizen Kane back in 1940, and in this story, we are going to learn all the struggles that Herman has to go through in fulfilling this masterpiece come into fruition. Now, Phil being the only person in this channel who's able to see Citizen Kane, it's only fitting that you start off discussion with your opinion. What do you think about this movie?
I've seen Citizen Kane when I was truly starting my appreciation for the art of filmmaking. And admittedly, during my first watch of Citizen Kane, I didn't see the big deal about it. It didn't particularly feel great for me. But as soon as I did some reading back in those days and I realized that there's a reason why they say that something is the Citizen Kane of something, which is basically the greatest of something, is because Citizen Kane introduced what is now commonly referred to as modern filmmaking. All the camera angles, the cinematography, the set design, the lighting, it all began with Citizen Kane. And after knowing that, it really gave me a bigger appreciation of that movie, as this movie is basically the bedrock of modern cinema. Before, I always thought that this Citizen Kane was the brainchild of Orson Welles and Orson Welles alone, because he is the producer for this, he's the director, he's also the screenwriter. But this movie says otherwise. This movie shed light on Herman Mankiewicz. He's not really mentioned much by cinephiles, and I'm really glad that this movie shed a light on him, because apparently this is the guy who wrote the screenplay for Citizen Kane without much of Orson Welles' help. And we all know that technique right now that his screenplay introduced is very commonly used in cinema, which is non-linear filmmaking. A lot of directors do that. I think that after Citizen Kane, the first movie that tried this style was Rashomon by Akira Kurosawa. That's a really great movie. Now, onto the movie in question. David Fincher did such a great job with this movie. David Fincher, as we all know, is also one of our favorite directors. The directors of movies like The Social Network, Seven, Gone Girl, and a series that you introduced to me, which is Mindhunter. I hope that gets back on air. He did a really great job with this movie. The way he made this movie is doing it like the style of the artist, where they shot something like it was made during the time that it was set upon. It's all in black and white. The audio design is very old school as well. The performances here is amazing. Gary Oldman is so good at this role, and the script is very, very on point. And we see here the character of Herman Mankiewicz struggle with alcoholism, and it's really interesting to see him try to finish this script on a very, very tight schedule. And for him to make such a great screenplay on such a short time is just mind-boggling to me. We also saw here that Citizen Kane is very personal to him, because this film also showed us that it is based on some people that he knew all throughout his life, somewhat making this a revenge screenplay of sorts. And that's a really interesting element for me. So Kevin, to be honest, I had a great time with this movie.
Yeah, I mean, from a technical standpoint, I really, really commend. There's nothing David Fincher can do wrong these days, even if this is his somewhat of a comeback movie. The most notable aspect here is how David Fincher captured that 1930s Hollywood, and I know to a degree some of the diehard cinephiles will appreciate this more. I mean, personally, I haven't seen much of the classics. I might have my cinephile card revoked if I mention some of those. But you know, just capturing this bubble Hollywood, and everything has to come together in terms of recreating the production design, the backlots of the Hollywood studios portrayed here, also in the terms of the brand of acting, the cinematography, the way that they played on the light and the shadow. That is a really tough task. And also with that screenplay, the level of banter, for the lack of a better term, some sort of an Aaron Sorkin-esque screenplay, that there's a lot of banter and hard to get along with. So that creates an alienation from a casual viewer. Granted that this movie, from the moment that I've seen this trailer, this movie is not going to be for casual viewers. And when it comes to the allusion allusions to the Citizen Kane. I don't know if this is just me, but I don't really find much allusion, which in a way helped me in not making me feel further more alienated, though I really could have used more context on what Citizen Kane is all about, because I really did not do my homework here. I did not watch Citizen Kane, let alone learn what the gist of that movie is all about. That's why I'm really glad that you also dropped that trivia about how Citizen Kane introduced that non-linear storytelling approach, because in the same way, Mank also followed that same approach. We find Mank here at the beginning of the story, deserted in this some sort of a retreat ranch in which he's given a deadline to finish this script. Then along the way, we go back to his past on how he has achieved this state, on how he has fought for the rights of Citizen Kane. And all the while, I just know that Citizen Kane is somewhat of a complicated and a grand project, that the producers are not really in favor of it. And apart from that, I don't really have a good grasp on what Citizen Kane is about, and I felt like I could have used more context. It kind of created a disconnect for me from that level. This movie already got my attention from the beginning because of its filmmaking, but I guess the magic quickly dissipates, because at the end, I need to have a narrative that's going to hook me. Maybe in a way, it has to do with the screenwriting here. The screenwriting is really aligned with the grand vision that David Fincher really chose to portray. I'm somewhat perplexed on why he chose to do this project, apart from this is a work done by his father. In a way, yeah, that's his legacy, and it's only fitting that David Fincher is the one who brings it to life. I didn't fully understood what David Fincher wants to make, aside from the whole point that this is a story about giving credit where credit is really due. So yeah, it's really nice to see Howard Mankiewicz get his version of truth, because I felt like there are juicier aspects of the movie that I felt like it remained on a surface level because of the script writing that mostly deals on banter, one of which is actually how these tech moguls have dominated the Hollywood industry. That subject matter in particularly, I find it reflecting today. Like, say, Disney has acquired a lot of these production companies, and looking on the more fresh upstart ones, we have Netflix. So I think that has something to say about what's happening in the past being echoed to the present. So maybe that's just my bias. Just in the screenplay level of writing, I don't really get involved much on the character dynamics to have a good grasp of their relationships. For example, I really love the platonic relationship that Herman Mankiewicz here has with Amanda Seyfried's character, Marion Davies. Yep. In a way, they are both outsiders to the Hollywood, like they are being overshadowed, like they're just being called as puppets. I wish that had more emotional punch in me. And also there are some scenes where Herman Mankiewicz is arguing with his brother Joseph, played by Tom Felfrey, and I felt like I could have used more emotion in there. And in a way, the screenwriting hindered in appreciating those character dynamics, because in my experience, I felt like this character shined more when they were delivering monologues. There is a monologue of Herman here towards the end about socialism that I could have used more of that, just because these characters are almost forgotten for a casual viewer. I find it too distant to connect with them, and just the whole process of being invested on the Citizen Kane that I personally don't give a fig about. So yeah, I guess that's the big hindrance. Maybe I should have done more research, but I was just speaking for a casual moviegoer perspective.
Kevin, I completely agree with everything you said. Actually, that's the biggest weakness of this movie, is that it tends to be inaccessible. Because to be honest, I've watched Citizen Kane, and the only real value that I get from watching this movie is the occasion shots where it's straight out of Citizen Kane, and knowing the history of the inception of the characters of this movie. But yeah, I completely agree. The relationships in the movie Mank as a standalone movie isn't really fully well realized. It depends too much on the viewer to know the history of all these people to truly have a true appreciation for these characters, because I'm the same way. I really don't know all these people much from the golden age of Hollywood. For instance, there are politicians here that was introduced because a part of this movie is about an election. There are all these executives, these media moguls, all these characters. Their characters were just kind of thrown in there without really a proper introduction into who these people are. We are kind of left in the dark about the background of these people, so we just really can't connect with them. I completely agree with that. I think that the biggest drawback of David Fincher doing this movie is alienating viewers like us who don't know much about Golden Age of Hollywood. But I really just enjoyed this movie because of that occasional nod to Citizen Kane and the amazing performances here, especially by Gary Oldman. I think that Gary Oldman will be up for Best Actor, I think, in the Oscar for this. I'm quite sure that this is going to be an automatic nomination.
Of course, for sure.
But let's see how it plays out. And also the sharp script. You also mentioned this, that David Fincher really did a great job to emulate the period in which this was set upon. This movie is also an automatic nomination for Best Picture. This is also one of my favorite movies of the year because everything just felt so on point to me, except of course with the background of the characters. I'm going to give this movie a 4.5 out of 5 stars.
Yeah, I mean, it's just not about having characters that you have no idea who they are. Because I've seen a period show, say, The Crown. Mm. I have no idea who these people are around Queen Elizabeth. But I managed to grasp their full personalities and their psyche, though that is a series. In here, I don't really find something witty or remarkable in any of these characters apart from Amanda Seyfried's character, personally, and Gary Oldman's character. So there are a lot of question marks in my head, like why does poor Sarah, played by Tupence Middleton, keeps on staying by Herman's side all this time? Like, that is a big mystery to me. But but anyway, at the end of the day, no matter how mixed my reception will be, I know this is going to be loved by the Academy because the Hollywood loves making movies about
Hollywood.
making movies about themselves. Though I'm not sure if people outside Hollywood really care at all. So yeah, so there's the disconnect there, and really the strongest aspect here is the technical craftsmanship and the direction. I even enjoyed, you know, seeing those circular spots on the upper right part.
Yeah.
Look, we shot this in an old camera when in reality, you know, they shot this on digital. There is a shot here that they shot for 300 times.
Really?
David Fincher is notorious for taking so many shots, and that is his speech towards the end. So Gary Oldman really stood out. He makes this character complex and fascinating. And then Amanda Seyfried, there are some parts of this movie that I can't believe that I'm about to say this, but I felt like it's becoming dull and I was on the verge of being asleep. But whenever she's on screen, she brings energy and life, and I like that her portrayal here is not too of a standoff diva. It's just the normal amount of a celebrity power and, you know, radiating that screen presence back to the audience. But yeah, overall, for a technical standpoint, I would give this 5 stars, but at the end of the day, this movie doesn't really have much of a pull for me. As much as I hate giving this, I need to be true to myself, I'm giving this movie a 3 out of 5 stars.
I'm glad that you mentioned the trivia about him shooting a scene for 300 times, so we can say that David Fincher, is he the modern Stanley Kubrick?
Oh man.
Okay, and that's it for our review of Mank. If you like this video, hit that like button and subscribe to our channel.
Also, let us know what you think in the comment sections down below. Thank you so much for watching. Until then, see you on the next one.
Bye-bye.